Hello and welcome to Podcast Extra, episode 222. That's 222. Yes. Is that how you say that?
That's how you say it.
I'm Andrew. Some people call me Gitch. You're free to call me whatever you like, as long as it's anything positive and edifying to my spirit.
How about friend?
That's going to limit.
Friend. I like that.
Friend. So apparently last week the audio was horrible.
It may be horrible now.
Oh.
And you know who I'm going to blame?
We're going to blame Brian Schmuland, who's actually sitting in the room with us right now. He is one of our tech guys at the church. He's sitting in the room with us monitoring it. So anybody who's got a problem with the audio, bschmuland@northview.org.
Yep. And how long did he spend setting up?
How late in starting? A long time. Yeah, it's good, but it's going to be so... But if it's awesome, you should send an email to bschmuland@northview.org saying, wow, you are a magician.
Or A. Gulovich.
Love you, Brian.
At northview.org. I'm seated here with Kyle.
Hello.
With Paul.
Hello.
I always think Paul has the greatest radio voice here. If you agree, P. Siemens at northview.org. Brian?
Yep.
Yeah, Brian's sitting off in the corner.
So you have to show. No, I'm kidding. Mr. Steiger?
I'm present.
And Dr. Jeffrey Bucknam.
Yeah, that's me. Kyle, you didn't say Dr. Kyle Meeker.
I didn't, because Kyle's. I'd say more of a friend, more of a close friend.
He's actually a doctor.
Dr. Meeker sounds like a puppet.
You're thinking of Beaker from the Muppets.
Did you know the Muppets are going to be back on TV?
Really?
Yeah.
Yes, they're renewing the Muppets. I read an article recently that Miss Piggy is no longer fat and sour faced.
Oh, and apparently doesn't like Kermit anymore. Which I
see not like Kermit.
No, apparently they're going their separate ways.
What happened was they broke up. Yes, but then Kermit apparently has a new love. Which I'm like, Kermit.
Which is the other, which apparently is the other.
You need to
pig.
Be a one
it's
pig
a different
frog.
Looking
that's right.
pig.
One pig frog.
Yeah.
One pig frog.
Yeah.
Oh, so I think that's a mistake for them.
Oh, a huge mistake.
I do too.
Yeah, no, the twisted love between frog and pig, mm-hmm. Kermit and Miss Piggy, mm-hmm. really was the driving force behind that show.
It was magical.
Yeah. And in other news, Kraft Dinner has now officially changed and remarketed themselves as KD. Officially.
You're kidding me.
I'm very
serious. What's wrong with Kraft Dinner?
It's KD now.
Well, you know what? You saying it makes
me
want to
buy it.
Now
I want to go back to Kraft Dinner.
It's because Kevin Durant's the spokesman now.
Is he?
No.
But apparently now they changed some of the ingredients and now there's no artificial.
It's not dinner anymore?
There's no, yeah.
Doesn't
there's
cause
no
cancer
artificial. Yeah. There's no artificial. Isn't the whole
there's
that was the whole point
of it?
Yeah.
I think it's no artificial color now. The orange is now naturally
it's
achieved.
White.
Kraft Dinner?
No, is it orange?
No, it's still orange, but now it's not artificially orange.
Got it.
Naturally
there's
orange.
Nothing
that makes
better
no
than,
sense.
There's nothing better than natural orange. They just
right.
crumpled up some fall leaves and put it in there and you're
right.
good.
And like the pumpkin spice latte this year from Starbucks now has real pumpkin.
What true, did they have before?
True story. I can't answer
I'd
that.
I'd be lying if I told you that I wasn't excited about that. When I saw that it was coming out early, I was pretty stoked.
Do you have your Burberry scarf, too, and your when
yes.
you go get it?
Yes.
your shoulder bag.
My pumpkin spice latte.
Andy.
Tall, please.
Reeks of hipster.
I'd say Greg reeks more of hipster.
No, but Andy is all hipster all the time.
I don't know about that. I don't have a beard.
He doesn't have a beard.
If I had a beard, then
do you know
I'd be
with
true
your baldness,
hipster.
With your baldness and a beard, you would be if you grew it really, yeah. really
yes.
long, and yeah. you just
you'd look like Dr. Meeker,
Dr. Hipster.
So in the room right now, there are several people, and Andy and I are the only two people without a beard. So for those of you who have a beard, can I just say something? I was in a conversation with some young women recently, and I asked them. So in all seriousness, and I know you're not supposed to say this out loud, but do you hate the beards? And they were like, they're hideous and we hate all of them. Like what happened to people, men shaving their faces? Your daughters don't like it. Your wives don't like it. Listen, just stop.
Actually, my daughter likes my beard. Yeah, she wants me to grow it to be like Santa come Christmas time.
She wants you to love her.
Can you grow your beard like Santa?
That by saying that, you will love her more.
Do you know what's funny? One of the first things Jeff told me when we met is he said, "Hey, can I just talk to you about something?" And I was like, "Yeah, sure." He goes, I just want to talk to you about your soul patch. It's like, you remember that?
Yeah.
He's like, really? Do you need to have that, you know, bit of hair right under your lip? It was funny enough. Like a month later, I shaved it off
because
I thought about it. I'm like, you know, I guess I don't know. I've had it for a while. Maybe it's time to get rid of it.
Attaboy.
But see,
Jeff influenced.
Repent, Siemens.
Yes. No. I refuse.
So
my wife loves it.
No, she doesn't.
She'll send an email this week.
And it'll say, Paul Siemens needs to keep the beard.
I think it's manly. I'd keep it.
I think you look like a lumberjack.
But did these two girls really speak? Did they speak on behalf of all the whole female?
Let's just put it out there to the three girls who listen to our podcast. If you are in favor of beards, you should send us an email that says so. If you think that I'm right regarding the hideousness and how beards should not be socially acceptable, you should also send in an email to extra at northview.org.
And if you have an in with Starbucks, you're invited to send pumpkin
you
spice
like
lattes.
Hey, Jeff, do you not?
I do. He had a beard. Yeah,
That was a beard of all beards.
There's no question about it. Here's the funny thing about the beard, though.
Do you ever go to Costco and go to their cafe?
There's always a dude who works there with a beard, and he has to have like a beard covering.
There was a reason to shave.
He has to talk through this net.
Hysterical.
Yes.
Mouthful of
and
hair.
He's got this net over his chin,
and it's pinned up by his ears.
And I'm like, dude, just stop.
just shave it off.
Okay.
That's just shameful. But boys, keep the beard, man. I love it. It's manly. Don't listen to Jeff.
Okay.
That's some of the best advice I probably could give you.
Best advice?
Buy a razor.
Don't listen to Jeff.
Well, listen here. We got some questions to go through, so why don't we do that? Or we could keep bantering.
Oh, good.
We could talk about the Blue Jays.
Let's get into
it. Half our listeners have turned us off.
But no, there's a subject that I want to address soon, and it has nothing to do with beards.
Good.
Okay.
So I'm just going to let you know that.
Do that.
Oh, you have to wait and see, won't you?
Oh.
Says a carrot. I'm going to keep the people to the end of the podcast.
Because Jeff has,
I've got something
exciting.
Is it
an airing of grievance?
No, it's not an airing of grievance.
Question, is polygamy wrong?
Hey, didn't we already address this question?
Is polygamy wrong?
It's a follow-up.
It's a
Because a few weeks ago, we did talk about
How
polygamy.
Is that a follow-up?
So what was the other one? What was the other question?
The question a couple weeks ago talked about polygamy. You have to ask Darcy. He hosted.
Okay.
Or maybe Greg.
Yeah, I forgot.
We talked a little bit about polygamy, but the question here talks about, first of all, is it wrong? And then are there contexts where it's okay, like countries where it's legal? Is it okay then?
So here's the thing in the scriptures. The scriptures will provide some boundaries around polygamy, which has led some people to say, oh, the Bible tacitly approves of polygamy. Right, because the Bible and some of the Levitical laws will end up saying something like, "Yeah, if you have your first wife does this, you have another wife." These sorts of things, right? It's the law is actually trying to put some boundaries around it, so people will somehow think that that's God giving permission. That's not at all the case. And so I'm going to do what Jesus did when he had a conversation with the Pharisees over divorce. He said, instead of looking at the Levitical law where Moses talked about divorce and permitted it, why don't you go back further and go to the creation account and decide what God intended? And in that account, God intended prior to the fall for a man and a woman to be joined together, one flesh. Not one guy and two girls, or two guys and one girl, or two guys, or two girls, or whatever. There is a gender binary and a complementarity that takes place between these two people, husband and wife. And there's a rich significance to that that's communicated through the one flesh statement. So what is God's ideal? God's ideal is heterosexual marriage. How do people ruin that? Several ways. One of them is polygamy, which ended up becoming a very popular way in the ancient world because of some of the social some of the social problems that women had in terms of getting jobs or working, or there's a lot of patriarchy that meant so that women, the only way a woman could have any kind of standing in the community is that she was tied to a guy. And that it, a lot of those reasons for that polygamy arising is were sinful. So polygamy itself is not God's ideal. It's sinful.
And it's completely irrelevant whether or not it's legal or illegal in certain countries.
Yeah.
Yeah, divorce isn't illegal.
Right.
But we think it's wrong.
Mm-hmm. Adultery is not illegal.
So our Christian worldview would trump that what our government says.
Yeah. The government is going to change its mind on a thousand things. Again, that's one of the reasons why I'm drawing the attention back to the creation account here. Mm-hmm. Is that if you have questions at any point about, you know, what's right sexually or these sorts of things, you look back to the creation account, how God made the world. If you want to see how people are supposed to flourish, look how God made the world, because they were flourishing in the garden. That's what they were made to do there. Mm. And so when we break God's ideal in the garden is when the world breaks apart. And so this is a very consistent approach in the scriptures Jesus did this. Paul does this when he talks about homosexuality in Romans 1. The gender issue about whether or not women should teach or have authority in a church. Paul addresses this by going back to the created order, saying there's certain things that guys are made to do and certain things that women are made to do. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. So my argument is that, all this, the polygamy fits within that system.
So the scriptures regulate polygamy but don't legitimate it.
Don't legitimize it, yeah.
Don't affirm it as a good option.
Right, which is something that should be really noted, right? Because we read our Bibles all the time and we come to some really weird conclusions. Mm-hmm. Oh, the Bible says that polygamy is okay because it describes how one ought to live under it. The Bible says slavery is okay because it describes how one ought to live under it. There's no scripture anywhere that talks about slavery in a positive sense. There's no model in the Bible that says you should enslave people. Mm-hmm. It gives instructions for people who are living under that imperfect system. How do you live faithfully there? Which is a legitimate question to ask for the biblical writers, and they do. But it doesn't endorse it.
I see that actually quite a bit, where people will go, "Oh, the Bible talked about this, must be endorsing it." Or if it's, you know, a patriarch did this, must be endorsing it. No, you know, the Bible will, you know, describe what's going on at a certain time, but that doesn't mean that it's endorsing it.
Right. Yeah.
You can see that on multiple levels of different things that are taking place.
There's an instructor at CBC, shameless plug here, who coined a phrase, perhaps it wasn't him, but the Bible is descriptive on things rather than prescriptive. So this would be an instant like that.
Always?
In this case.
Is it always descriptive?
What do you think?
I think that there's lots of prescription in the scriptures.
I agree. But in cases like, because when we turn to the scriptures and say, oh, you know, polygamy or...
Right, but see, the critique from a critic would be that, you're just being arbitrary with what you call descriptive and prescriptive.
Right.
But if you understand the way that scriptures are written, right, oftentimes in a narrative, for example, the way that you highlight what you want people to do in a narrative is that there are heroes and villains, and the heroes are to be emulated and the villains to be avoided, their actions. That sort of thing you can perceive through a narrative, but then you have things that are more didactic, that are more teaching oriented, like the epistles, where you'll have the author say, "Do this, don't do that. Do this, don't do that." So, I'm just saying that you can usually tell by the context or the way that the thing is written whether or not the authors are telling you to follow the actions of one character or avoid the actions of another.
Can I just put a plug in here? This is one of those reasons why I think it's so important when you're like preaching the Old Testament or something like that you're constantly pointing people towards Christ. Because I think there's a problem though that we've made in the past where we'll edify somebody like King David, and then you'll read something about King David and his affair with Bathsheba, and it's not like the Bible's telling you that because it's telling you, oh, you should have an affair like King David. Say no, you shouldn't.
Right. Look what happens as a result of King David having an affair with Bathsheba.
But one of the problems we have is because we've lifted King David up so much, it really messes with a lot of people's minds because we forget, the Bible's not telling you about King David because he's the hero of the story. Hmm. He's telling you about a hero that's going to be coming. And in fact, he's going to come in the line of King David.
Right. Right. And polygamy, though, is interesting. I mean, it's interesting you bring up David because David, the rest of David's life after the sin with Bathsheba, his family situation, like it's all a mess. It's a colossal mess. This is the same kind of thing that happens when you read stories about polygamy. Like, just think about the different characters in Scripture that get into trouble because they have multiple wives. I'm thinking about Isaac, right? With yep. Leah and Rachel. It doesn't work out Jacob. Well for him. Sorry, Jacob, it's okay. With Leah and Rachel. So, but like so you have the example there is not a positive one in any way. Like it causes all sorts of problems. And the Bible forbids it anyway, right? Where it says you can't serve two masters.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right. Do you get that? That was a joke, but nobody got it.
I got it.
Okay, no, but in marriage
we were
is
supposed
a picture.
To laugh at that point.
You didn't. It was too clever.
Marriage is a marriage is a picture of God's relationship to his people, right? And so when his people have adulterous affairs and marry themselves off to other gods, this isn't a thing that makes God happy. So if marriage is a picture of that, then it's one man, one woman committed to each other for life, period.
Yep. Like Kermit to Miss Piggy.
Did they ever get married?
I don't know.
I think the where would they weddings live? Always fell apart. I know in the most recent Muppet movie it fell apart.
A frog can marry a pig, but where will they live?
Swamp, buddy.
Hey.
Lily pad.
You figured it out.
You figured it out.
Wow. Okay,
moving along.
But the second part of that question was, are there contexts, I think?
Yes, it talked about...
Okay, and this is something that missionaries actually have to deal with.
Yep.
Right?
That's right.
And so you get, sometimes a missionary will be somewhere in, wherever, it's Asia or Africa, mm-hmm. where you have communities where polygamy is a big part of it, but then you have the family comes to faith in Christ. So now what do we do, right?
Yeah. Right.
And that's a very difficult thing. And the husband, whatever happens sexually within those relationships, I don't know how that moves forward. But I know that the husband is still required to care for those women.
Right.
Because they're under his care.
Well, and the community and the social structures of that community have actually set it up so that those women, if they are left... out of his care, they will not be cared for by anyone.
Yeah,
and
right.
So you
cursed.
By creating by changing the polygamy
mm-hmm.
are actually undercutting the way that the society as a whole works. Now listen, I'm actually suggesting that in the long run that's exactly what you want to do.
Right.
You actually want to do that. But in the short run, you might have somebody in your church, if you're a missionary, who's a polygamist and he's got three wives and he's caring for them, but you as a pastor are not just encouraging, you're calling him to listen. You need to treat your first wife as your only wife, and the other two you have a responsibility to care for them and their children and these sorts of things, but to abstain from sexual relations with them. So this is the kind of things that missionaries have to work with, but they take the long view, right? They don't say, well, we're going to come in here and everything's got to change immediately to look exactly like the goal. We work toward that goal, right? In a trajectory toward that goal. You might not reach it for lots and lots of years, but isn't that what all ministry is?
Yeah.
I mean, we meet with people all the time whose lives are imperfect. My life isn't perfect.
It
I'm
is?
Working toward a goal.
No, so, it right. definitely is.
Well,
no,
you look at God's patience towards us.
Yeah.
And when we're reaching out to others, we need to have patience in their walk, right? Like somebody comes to Christ, but they're still doing whatever. I mean, we have to have patience and slowly walk them through these things and show them in the Scriptures why this is wrong. Let the Holy Spirit do his work of convicting them.
Yeah.
And sometimes it doesn't happen as fast as we want, but we gotta exercise patience.
As long as they're willing
to
be moving in a direction of submission to Christ and his word, then we're good.
Yeah.
It's the moment where people start getting their back up and saying, no, I don't want to obey Jesus at that point, that you're like, oh.
Yeah.
But even then we strive, right? We continue mm-hmm. to strive and to seek their repentance and seek their good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen.
You're welcome.
Let's move on. This next question here is a little heady, so buckle up. You ready?
Heady.
Ready.
Andy's ready. Okay, Andy, then maybe you can answer it. So I'll just make a couple of statements that this listener has made.
Teddy.
We are relatively certain that neurological impulses birth consciousness. We know for certain that neurological impulses precede exertions of consciousness. You with me?
I'm with you.
Which include acts and of will and choice. If both of these statements are true, will cannot exist freely in any form. It begs the question then, what governs the impulses? And how does this fit in with Christianity?
Yeah, first, there's a number of things that are happening there.
You might want to restate the question?
Is he saying there's no such thing as free will?
Well here, that's result of what he's saying.
Okay.
I'll restate the question.
Yeah, in language that will be accessible to most people who are listening.
As your mind works, you have these neurological fibers that are firing. They're called C fibers. And as they fire, you're having these electrical impulses in your mind. That's what, scans are scanning and seeing, what kind of electrical impulses are taking place in the brain. And these electrical impulses in your brain correlate to different actions, potentially, such as maybe my arm moving or something like that. And the question becomes then is, am I just a bunch of neurological C fibers firing? So am I just in a lightning storm in the brain?
Are you a meat computer?
Another way of putting it is, am I just a meat computer? And, and nothing more. And if that's the case, it means then that everything is just determined. In fact, you'd have to deduce it down to even your DNA.
We're talking about a hard determinism here. Like if you're a meat computer, then any kind of input, just like if I push a keystroke on a computer, it registers a response by the computer. So the inputs, whether it be visual or other things that go into you, produce an automatic response.
That's right. And this would be naturalism.
Oh, yeah.
At its core is hard determinism.
Right.
And you can push us even farther back to humans just being particles in motion. Now, here's the problem that this question is begging and the person's asking. Well, what is those C fibers firing? What is that electrical impulse that's taking place in the brain? Now, you've only got, you got two options here. One is naturalism, and that is that this was scripted by your DNA. This is a part of actually the cosmic explosion of the Big Bang. This is just the way your particles are moving in motion, and that you can do none other. It's like Jeff was saying, this is a hard determinism.
Which, by the way, that viewpoint is it's the prevailing viewpoint of our culture. What's very interesting is that people who hold that viewpoint will talk about freedom. Yeah. We'll talk about some guy who commits a crime as if, well, he chose to do it. Well, actually, your worldview says he didn't. So there is no such thing as somebody who should go to jail for rape, for example, because he is just responding. His DNA forced him to do that thing.
On a hard determinism, how can you say anyone's at fault?
Well, you're not. You're not. You're just a computer, and you're responding to the impulses that were given you.
The irony goes deeper, because the irony in this question is, well, how could you ever know this? If a hard determinism is true, does that mean then you were determined to determine that it's a hard determinism?
Right.
Right? It becomes self-refuting. It's very problematic. I mean, the question becomes, begs the question, how is it that you have risen above determinism to even ask the question about determinism? Right. And this becomes, for me, one of the big problems of naturalism. That's one way of viewing things. As Jeff said, a lot of people think that way, and I see a problem.
And it would be consistent for those people to say that there is no such thing as freedom. If you accept those premises,
that's correct,
presuppositions, then yes, the necessary outcome would be that there is no such thing as freedom.
I heard a professor at Duke University say this once, talking on hard determinism, which I thought was quite interesting. He was a naturalist and said, listen, professionally, philosophically, I believe that naturalism is true and I have no free will. But I don't live as though that's true.
Right. I play a game.
That's
We play this, we use language of choice as a game.
Yeah. And that's our culture. Right. Our culture plays this game.
So what you should hear us saying, though, is that we don't agree with that.
Yes.
But the reason we don't agree with that is because we believe in the immaterial soul.
So this is a duality then. I would say that two things exist. One is the physical world and the non-physical world. And so I would say that we have both a brain and a mind. The brain would be the physical. The mind would be the immaterial. And in fact, we talk in everyday language like this. I'll say, Jeff, you were on my mind this weekend. But I would never say, Jeff, you were on my brain this weekend. And if you were, I would be in big trouble, right? Because we understand that there's this duality that's taking place. And so under the Christian worldview, we believe that those C-fiber firings, you know, I guess maybe you could find some Christians that are hard determinists, but that Christians believe that those are not determined by your DNA. They're not determined by, you know, the cosmic direction of your atoms, that you actually have a will, and that there isn't this, not to get overly complicated, but there isn't this infinite regress of causes, that a person can be a primary cause.
You make genuine choices, is what everybody would agree with, that human beings make genuine choices that have genuine consequences to their actions, that they are complicit in what they're doing.
And to answer this, the question then is, what was the last part?
How it fits into Christianity.
Yeah, and how it fits into Christianity is that we believe that personhood isn't just left to humanity.
It's not just physical.
Yeah, exactly. That ultimately we were made in God's image, and that God is a person. Not that God's that God is humanity, if you will. That God's a human being.
Well, in Christ, he was.
But in Christ, he was in the incarnation. You could look at the economic trinity or is. But ultimately, we would talk about an ontological trinity, that we would be talking about who is God, and that God in his essence is actually person, that he is in relationship to himself, and that God is free. He's not determined.
Right.
And that he's able to make real choices.
So one of the great illustrations of this that both Kyle and I heard J.P. Moreland give in a class that we had was that he was trying to show that the human being is like a car. If you just follow the image for a minute, a car has a steering wheel, right? But the car without a driver, even though it might have a steering wheel, isn't going to go anywhere, right? It has the potential to go somewhere, but it doesn't go anywhere. This is his point, that the brain is the steering wheel of the person. But the soul, or in Andy's language, mind, is the driver of the person. So we are.
So they work together,
right? So you, can the body go somewhere without its brain? Well, no. Can the body go somewhere without its soul? No. No, no, it can't.
Can a car go somewhere without
a driver? So they rely upon, I mean, the one relies upon the other, but the materialists or naturalists want to say, well, no, you are your brain. So when they talk about love, they'll put your brain on an image and it'll light up in places, and they'll say that's love. And we all know that's ridiculous. Love is not just your brain firing. It is something deep within you. The feelings and senses that you have are something that is deep, deep inside. The images that you can conjure in your mind, I cannot crack your head open today and find them in a physical sense. I can't, well, maybe I'd like to do that with you, Kyle. If I say pink elephant, I can't now crack your head open and find a picture of a pink elephant, even though you can see it in your mind. So That's what we're getting at, that there is an immaterial, the real you is immaterial and material, right?
Absolutely. And to maybe just give an example of how this works is kind of just a, because people might say, well, how do you know the world's immaterial? Let me just give you one argument for that, and then we can move on if we're done here. But take what's on my wrist right now. If we were to take the naturalist perspective, I would say that what's on my wrist right now, I would deduce it down to its base component parts. It's made of plastic and metal and glass, right? And on science, on a scientific naturalist point of view, I mean, how could I say any more about what's on my wrist right now? Using the laws of physics, using the laws of chemistry and mathematics, can I say anything more about what's on my wrist right now? And we would say, well, no. But yet you would say, but that's not what's on my wrist right now. That there's something more there. And ultimately you would say that that what's on my wrist is a watch and that it has a purpose.
And a design.
And these things can come together for a specific reason. Now, persons are able to do that. We're able to put things together with purpose and meaning for an intended purpose. And these things are beyond the natural world. You can't describe these things on a natural process. Now, this question that was written in, you could do the same thing with a human being. You could say that all that's happening in your mind is a bunch of chemical reactions. And so the question you have to ask yourself is, do I think that I am just a bunch of chemical reactions that are taking place that have somehow come to the place that I could write in an email asking about the chemical reactions that are going on inside my mind, right? And ultimately, I'm going to say, again, that's just nonsense, that you realize that there is an intended purpose to you and that you're more than just, chemical reactions and particles, that you're a person.
That was fun.
Mm-hmm. Very much. That was a lot of fun.
I'm glad Andy was here.
You wrote a book about something.
No, you didn't.
It had nothing to do with this. Move on.
You, Dr. Jeff, had something you wanted to bring up, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes, it's actually a... Is this the final
album? This is
album?
The time. This will be the time. Mm.
We've been all over the map, so we might as well. What do you guys think of what's happened in Kentucky with Kim Davis, is her name?
Yeah.
And she has been jailed by the governor of Kentucky for refusing to put her name on marriage licenses between same-sex couples.
Yeah, I want to talk about this.
And she's refused to put her name on the marriage licenses. She's currently today, she's in jail. And when you're listening to this, there might be further developments in this story, but today she is in jail. She is the county clerk, which is an elected position, right? So you can't just say, the governor can't just say, well, you're fired because she is an elected official. The way you fire an elected official is you impeach them in the state, which means you go to the legislature of that state and they have to pass a censuring law against her.
I think that's a
referendum
too.
Isn't it even a referendum?
I don't know if it's a, I don't think it's a referendum. I think
they,
that the
when
legislature
they talked about this on
to.
The news, they talked about how most of the people in the area were supporting her.
Right. Well, that's the crazy part. So even if they went,
impeachment wouldn't.
Well, and the elected officials would be worried about what would happen if they said, well, we're going to impeach her.
Right.
Because they wouldn't probably be elected because most of the people in Kentucky agree with her that she should feel free to do this. The big issue here, I've talked to a lot of people about this, but the big issue here that I find particularly interesting is that what you have here is you have a woman who is trying to maintain her religious freedom while doing a job for the government, who is asking her to do do something that is going to be an affront to her. Mm-hmm. So this would be very similar to a Muslim being asked to, or a Jew, a Jewish person being asked to eat a pig as part of their job. So,
sure.
So do you give them some kind of way around it? Or do you demand that they be fired or that they quit their job because of that? And so it's been really interesting because I see a lot of Christians who have fallen on very different sides. One side was saying, well, she should quit her job. Well, there is a side that says she shouldn't worry about it at all. This is dumb. Why are you even making a big deal about this? Same-sex marriage is the law of the land. We all just need to get in line. There are a bunch of Christians who are saying, well, no, even though same-sex marriage is a law of the land, we should be civilly disobedient about it. And the way you do that is you quit your job if it requires you to do something like this so you can maintain your conscience. The third group is, no, you don't need to quit your job. Make them fire you. Subvert it. You know what I mean? Stay in your job. Work in that role to bring about a more righteous world. So, boys, what do you think?
Well, the interesting thing that I read a really interesting article from the legal perspective that was published in the Washington Post of this. I think he was a lawyer who wrote it, and it was put out. If you want to look it up, it's, I think it was on the Gospel Coalition website. John Piper said, tweeted it. Anyway, and this lawyer basically said that her argument was not like she
her
didn't
being
want
Kim the
her
the,
Kim yes yeah. Kim Davis didn't want her name on these because it was going against her beliefs.
Right.
And Kentucky has something called the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which tells the government they need to make provisions for people who have this kind of argument.
Right.
And this lawyer was saying her argument definitely falls within the parameters of that. So all the legislature actually would need to do is put some kind of a general title on there instead of her name.
Right. And this is what North Carolina's done. They actually have made it so that if somebody because the issue is that she came to office prior to this decision. So the Supreme Court makes the decision. So people would say, well, Kim Davis is the one who's being obstinate here. Well, actually, it's the Supreme Court of the United States who changed the rules on her.
Right.
She didn't come into, so that you changed the rules on me. I'm an elected official into this thing. You're asking me to do something now, put my name on something that I think is morally reprobate. Yeah. So you need to make provision for me. They have refused to do that. I mean, they've jailed her, which is just not funny, but
it's pretty ridiculous.
The interesting thing is, a lot of people have pointed this out, is just the double standard that we've seen because of this. Because 6 months ago, you had counties and cities providing marriage licenses to same-sex couples when it was illegal to do so.
Right.
And none of those people were jailed, and nobody was demanding even that those people get put in jail. But now here we have somebody on the other side of the fence, just because they play for the other team.
So the question that I want to raise, though, is not necessarily the legal piece. If you want to read a really excellent piece on this, the New York Times op-ed piece by Ryan Alexander, you can do a Google search for Ryan Alexander, New York Times, and Kim Davis, and you will find his piece that summarizes a lot of this stuff, and it's very helpful to read. But the reason I wanted to bring it up is because this is the sort of thing that is increasingly going to be the case in the Western world, right?
Yes.
Especially in the United States and Canada and in Europe, New Zealand, Australia, where you have historically, our constitutions and our governments, even when they first began, had provisions in them and continue to have provisions for religious freedom. But on the flip side, you have the government now endorsing certain kinds of laws or certain kinds of activities that we find to be morally unsatisfactory. That's a nice way of saying it, right? I mean, like we have laws that say, no, you can abort the child. So what does a doctor do who's put in a position where he's being asked to and even forced by the government to abort children? Or a pharmacist who's being asked or required by the government to hand over pills, prescribed pills, for a person who's going to that are abortifacient pills. Mm-hmm. You're complicit now in the murder of a child, or in this case, you're complicit in a same-sex marriage. What do you do? These are the questions that the church is going to have to deal with in the next number of years, and pray that governments like ours will make allowances for us, for bakers and photographers and others who
don't
are.
Don't you
in
think?
These
don't you think issues? It makes her situation a little more difficult in that it's an elected position, and that she represents the state.
Right. It does. It does. The question, I think the question is that I want to ask people, and I don't have completely the answer, but I would love to have people start thinking about it, is what kind of civil disobedience are you willing to show? Because here's the thing. Let me compare this.
Yeah.
Let me compare this. In the 1930s in Germany,
yes,
the government was asking and demanding people to do things that were immoral. Whether they be working on train tracks that were delivering Jews to gas chambers. These are normal people who lived in towns. The Nuremberg trials after World War II came to the conclusion that those people were complicit. They should have acted to stop this immoral thing. That there is a law above the law of Germany, and the law, of course, in the Nuremberg trials was actually an appeal to God and the natural law of God. Mm-hmm. And you have a responsibility to do. So if you're a faithful Christian, we need to be thinking to ourselves, what is our responsibility? Not just in the same sex issue, but in all these different issues, what kind of responsibility do we have to seek the good of the land? And the good of the land is in human flourishing the way that God would intend it to be. And so these are real questions. It's not just something you can close your eyes to. These are real questions if we want to love our neighbors.
I'm reminded of the Hebrew midwives too. Shifra and Puah.
Right.
So they were being asked to basically kill Hebrew babies.
And they didn't.
And they didn't. Yeah.
But should they have quit? So they subverted. That's what's interesting about this is that they subverted, meaning that they stayed in their positions and carried out the law in a way that was different than what the Pharaoh said.
Yeah.
And so they are held up as
the Hebrew women are just.
Yeah, no, they made up an excuse.
That they just pop out babies.
The kids come out so fast; they get there in time.
But they're held up as heroines, okay, for not doing what the government said. So, look, there's lots of different ways for there to be civil disobedience. What's hard for the Christian church, I think, in this moment, is that we are not used to being people who have to be civilly disobedient, right? We should be. Because our governments have historically, all of our governments have historically done heinous things like killing unborn children and lynching black people and displacing whole masses of humanity off their land. Yeah. We should be civilly disobedient, right? With sex slavery and the kinds of laws that permit it and even things having to do with the financial sector and the laws that permit people to rape and pillage in a financial way.
Right.
We should be seeking to redeem our setting, right? Be faithfully present in whatever it is that the Lord's placed us in, to seek a way to transform that setting into the image of Christ and under his lordship, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is part of our mission. And so it's an interesting moment in the United States where you have an actual example of somebody that's real tangible, but should be the actual example for all of us. Mm-hmm. Whether you agree with what Kim Davis is doing, whether you think she should have quit or not, we can debate. Or whatever, but the idea that she's being civilly disobedient as a Christian is something I think all of us need to take note of.
And it's close to home too, because for all y'all who are indentured or credentialed by the Providence of BC to be able to marry people, if you got approached by a same-sex couple to perform their wedding to do that, what would you?
Yeah, and these are the these are the challenges, right? That you face. Right. My response would be that I'm out of weddings altogether.
Yeah. So.
Right, because I think
now you have a situation in Oregon where there's a judge. And this just came out, I think, last week. There's a judge who's pulled himself away from being a justice of the peace. At all weddings because of this, and they're calling for him to be kicked off the bench.
And he might be, right?
Yeah,
he might be. There's a long history of Christian people who have stood their ground, and have felt the mighty hand of the state.
Yeah.
Come against them, right? And not everybody ends up being saved from the fires, right? And walk out in miraculous ways. Sometimes you get sawn in two.
Yeah.
But you know what? Before God, we have responsibilities. To him and to our brothers and sisters in Christ and to a community who doesn't know any better.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Well, that's all the time we have. So, gentlemen, thank you for your time. Brian, thanks for all your insights and wise words.
Yep.
And tech help. we'll see you guys again next week. Thank you. All right.